Hey guys, in this area we will understand what is the valuation of particular share when we compare, because this kind of valuation will only help us to find a theoretical value of particular share. When we find out the theoretical value of particular share, we will help us to know whether the share is overvalued or undervalued. If the share is overvalued, we need to decide whether we need to buy the share or we need to sell the share. So the method I will suggest you, it will help you to calculate the theoretical value of particular share, and it will give you a bigger picture about what is the valuation of particular share and how can we decide whether to sell it or whether to have it or sell it. So we need to make it more simpler than that. So in theoretical value, we should compare with the market value. We'll decide whether to buy or sell, that is overpriced or underpriced. Whether the share is overpriced or whether the share is underpriced, we need to decide based on that. So in this basic valuation chapter, we will understand how can we define the particular valuation of particular share and how can we make it possible to find a exact value of the share. The valuation of the shares can be divided in this formula. We can find the value by using a net asset value method. Net asset value method will help us to understand what do you mean by the exact valuation of the share. So we will find the second method we'll use is dividend yield method. Third method is earning yield method. Fourth is productivity factor method. Fifth is PE multiple method. PE is nothing but price and earning. And sixth is discounted cash flow method. This all method we study in detail. So first method that we are using is net asset value method. Net asset value method will help us to explain what is the net asset of particular company divided by number of equity shares the company is holding. So step one is the value of the asset. Total value of the asset we need to find out, including goodwill. Keep in mind, asset will include goodwill amount. Goodwill being an intangible asset, we need to include that amount. That's the reason asset amount will always include goodwill. Step 2 is value of liability. Value of liability is different part. Value of liability is nothing but my liability side. It will include my preferential claim. Preferential claim is nothing but the claim that I have been holding for shareholders. So asset less liability divided by number of equity shares will help us to realize what is the net asset value method. Example I have taken for the Apple company. My asset is $1,000 and my liability is $500 and number of shares is 500. Total issue price of the share is only 500. Quantity of share have been floated in the market, and my 500 divided by 500, then the net asset value of per share is only $1 per share. This is my theoretical price. If my market price is 0.5 cents, then my share have been undervalued. That's the reason my share have been undervalued. That's the reason in this case I will buy my share, because my share market is 0.5 and my valuation is coming to $1. But the share have been undervalued, we have to run fast and buy the share, because this opportunity will never come in our life. So guys, in the dividend yield method is nothing but the kind of dividend what the company is gaining and what are the factors the company is expecting from us. We need to compute the dividend rate of the company. In this method, first step is compute the dividend rate of the company. How to compute the dividend rate of the company is this: distributed profit divided by paid up value of equity shares. What are the profit the company have been distributed, the dividend given to the company, and divided by paid up value of equity share, we'll get a dividend rate of the company. Then we need to find a dividend rate of the market. This company, example company is automobile company, maybe Maruti, or we can take a Tesla. Entire market dividend may be something higher. So the export example, company dividend rate may be 12% and market rate may be 16%. So we can, there is deviation for that. The value per share can be as follow: paid up value per share divided by the company's dividend rate divided by market rate divided by adjusted risk factor. Now we'll explain what do you mean by adjusted risk factors. Adjusted risk factors is nothing but the deviation the company is facing from that. For example, Maruti is facing some other, the automobile industry as a whole. There is a Maruti, there is a Tesla, there may be a Kia, there may be Kia. This entire industry, maybe I am calculating the share of Maruti Industries. तो मारुति इंडस्ट्रीज का कंपनी मे हैव सम काइंड ऑफ एडवांटेज और मे हैव सम काइंड ऑफ डिसएडवांटेज कंपेयर टू एंटायर इंडस्ट्री. वी नीड टू एडजस्ट दैट एडवांटेज एंड डिसएडवांटेज दैट हैव बीन हैपनिंग इन द कंटीन्यूअस मार्केट. वी नीड टू एडजस्ट दैट फैक्टर एंड देन लेटर ऑन वी विल मेक इट क्लियर व्हाट काइंड ऑफ फैक्टर्स द कंपनी इज मेकिंग थ्रू आउट दैट पार्ट. वी नीड टू मेक दैट क्लियर नाउ एंड देन then we'll do there's a paid up share capital of the company. We need to divide by a percentage dividend rate of the company divided by b percentage. So we will find out the valuation per share as per dividend yield method. This valuation, we have studied valuation as per NAV method. This valuation has per dividend yield method. Hey guys, in this chapter this is the third valuation model is nothing but earning yield method. There are various steps for calculation of this method. Earning yield method will help us to understand what is the earning of a particular company and what kind of valuation based on earning we have to give to the company. This is valuation based on earnings. Last one is net asset value method, second is dividend yield method, and this earning based method. The first step is we have to compute the future maintainable profit, FMOP. FMOP is after deducting a preference dividend. FMOP is the future maintainable profit of particular company. We need to take a balance sheet of particular company. Profit and loss may be able to show the what kind of profit the company is earning. We need to deduct the preference share dividend on that part. Then we have to calculate what is the normal rate of return the company is giving or the normal rate of return in the entire market. We need to compare both the rate of return and we need to choose the optimized rate of return that we are expecting from the company. This is the normal rate of return, one rate of return the company is giving. We need to adjust NRR with the risk factor. As we already discussed NRR is basically the risk factor by what is the company is facing and the certain risk company is facing and the certain benefit company is getting. We need to compare both benefit and risk and then we need to adjust NRR based on the risk factor. Step four, we need to find out the actual valuation based on profit. This is the future maintainable profit of the particular company at the year one. Say then we will divide by a percentage. This value. This is basically this come in this method. This is basically a value divided by percentage. We'll get a full amount based on profit. This is the provisional profit the company is earning. For example, year one my profit may be 1,000 rupees. 1,000 rupees profit, and the NRR is 10%. 10% is the basic NRR. And risk adjusted NRR may be 8%. I adjusted the risk of 2% and basic risk adjusted NRR is 8%. Then what is the FMOP? That is step 4. 4 valuation, that is 1,000 rupees divided by 8%. We'll get the value of exact value the company is adjusting. So total asset available to equity shareholders means what? Step 4. Because we need to find out what are the asset held by equity shareholders. We have find out this in this basic example. We have already deducted the preference dividend from the profit. So means the percentage, the whole value is belonging to the equity shareholder. This is the basic value belonging to equity shareholder. Then on that amount, we need to add a non-trade investment. Non-trade investment is basically debt investment that company is not using in a day-to-day routine. It's a non-trading investment. It's a parked investment that is only and solely belong to equity shareholder. So we need to add that value. Then it will come a total value of a particular equity shareholder. Then we need to divide that into number of equity shares. Now number of equity shares, then we will get a value per share. You get a value per share. This is a valuation based on earning yield method. What we have done, we have found at the FMOP, then we have divided with NRR. NRR is nothing but normal rate of return, or we need to adjust with this. This FMOP will be after preference dividend. We do deduct dividend because FMOP is only and solely belong to equity shareholder. Then we do add a non-trade investment amount. Non-trade investment amount is the amount that the company is holding apart from other part. Then we need to divide number of equity shareholders so that we can get an exact per share value based on earning yield method. In case of productivity factor method, we need to compute the return on capital employed. What is the actual return on capital employed this company is getting from other part? We need to find that what is the actual return on capital employed. Return on capital employed will be defined by PBIT divided by capital employed. PBIT is profit before interest and tax. Will divide by capital employed. Capital employed will include three factors: my equity, my debt, and my preference shareholder. What are the actual capital employed in the business? Then from that I will find my return on capital employed. What is the actual return on capital employed I'm getting from this part? For equity shareholder, we need to find out what are the valuation for the equity shareholder. Valuation for the equity shareholder can be divided in this. This is PBIT. PBIT is profit before interest and tax for the equity shareholder. We need to less the interest on debt, tax, and preference dividend. We need to deduct the amount of profit that belong to dividend, amount of profit that belong to preference shareholder, and amount of profit that belong to others. So I need a pure profit for equity shareholder. Then we'll divide. Then after what step two we will divide into percentage. So again the same concept. It is value divided by percentage. So we'll get a full amount. Again it's the same concept, value divided by percentage, we get a full amount. In this part, so my value per share is nothing but my step three. Step three I'm getting over the year, and the number of equity share. Number of equity shares is the total equity share company is owning. Per I don't forget to add a non-trade investment in a step 3. Step 3 we need to add non-trade investment, because non-trade investment is an investment that is kept aside by the shareholder. We need to add it because the company needed it the most. This is the last concept we are heading into. This is the fifth step. By using a PE multiple method, we need to find out PE, then we need to get into the exact valuation of particular equity share. We need to compute the earning per share. First is earning per share. Earning per share is nothing but EPS. EPS, this is earning per share. The number of equity share company is holding divided by number of shares. The number of shares earning of particular company divided by number of share will get earning per share EPS. Then we need to find a PE ratio. PE ratio is nothing but market price divided by EPS. For example, Reliance market price is 1600 and earning per share may be around 800 is earning per share, so it will be 2. PE is 2, means I required a 2 year of earning to get the market price of the share. Once again I repeat, I require 2 years of earning to get a market price per share, so it will be a PE. PE means how much earning we required, how much years of earning we required to cover my market price. Okay, we need to decide the PE. Then we need to adjust the PE based on the risk factor of that industry, because for example each and every industry have a different risk factor and each and every company have a different risk factor. In the recent news we are hearing the Amazon got some kind of conflicting, the Trump government have issued some kind of litigation regarding an Amazon that they cannot sell a duplicate item or conflicting item. So this is a risk factor for the particular Amazon, not for the entire market. Amazon have been listed for the particular conflicting issue, but not for the entire market. So PE ratio we will decide based on that factor that the government issuing for the particular reason. So we need to divide the value of the particular share. Then this earning per share into adjusted this PE, we will get the value. This is value per share. Based on that we need to compare it with the market value of the per share, then we will decide what kind of the exact valuation we are doing here. Thank you. This is the last for valuation of shares. Further there is a cash flow, discounted cash flow approach. We'll study in part 2 what is the discounted cash flow approach in the detailed manner. Thank you. This video will end now.